Good morning, everybody. As a matter of introduction to Mr. LRT, he needs no introduction anyhow. I would like to say a few words about him. Mr. Om Prakash LRT is a famous and designated senior litigator of Madras High Court, and he has got a rich 27 years of experience in the bar as a practicing lawyer. His area of specialization includes civil original site, civil appellate, and of course the coveted jurisdiction High Court. And his appearance is also spread to Supreme Court, where he appears quite frequently. He has been known for his prowess in the fields of commercial law, more importantly, and his appearances spread like anything in the extrajudicial courts and tribunals called DRT, DRAT, NCLT, and NCLAT. Today's subject is a new subject, IBC, and we have deviated a lot from the law of insolvency. And I hope in due course of time, when the GOs are notified, civil court will be divested of the jurisdiction and the jurisdiction would be conferred to the DRTs. So with this note, I very wholeheartedly welcome Mr. Valanti. Mr. Valanti, sir, you are welcome. Please share your interest knowledge, sir, with our parties. Welcome, sir.
Thank you very much, sir. Good morning, friends. I'm happy to be part of this session this morning hour. At the outset, I need to thank Mr. Srinivasa Raghavan, Ms. Hemalata, and their law officers, which have been very active from the start of our lockdown to ensure that the advocates are kept busy. At the toughest time of being confined to homes, they had given us this wonderful opportunity of learning a lot of new things. In fact, during this entire period of 2 or 3 weeks when we have been going through these lectures, we had very good sessions from judges, senior advocates, learned members of bar on various topics. I sometimes feel that but for this, we could not have learned all those things with the running times, with your time schedules in the courts and your office work. It has become very tough nowadays to get into some new subject and try to learn that. But this lockdown has helped us, and these good souls have really put forth their efforts in seeing that it extends to all the legal fraternity. More interestingly, the younger members of the bar are being provided this opportunity, and I see that a lot many people have utilized this opportunity to learn new things. Having said that, today's session is on Insolvency and Bankruptcy Code 2016. We shortly call it as IBC. The Act is a consolidation of various laws on the then prevailing and continues to be prevailing laws on insolvency of corporates as well as individuals, including partnership firms and limited liability partnerships. Now, what was the need for an enactment? Is it that there was no law which was dealing on the subject of insolvency? It is not so. It is one of the oldest laws. When you look at the commercial law, the earliest point is on the laws relating to insolvency or failure in businesses, unable to pay the liabilities. These were the areas where commercial laws were at the threshold time. So therefore, we had laws which were providing for insolvency resolution. As you are aware, when we speak about insolvency of corporates, namely companies, we had the provisions under the Companies Act by which if there is an issue of an inability to pay, I'm emphasizing this word, inability to pay, because that was the regime which was in place. If there is a case of an inability to pay by a company, then we used to invoke the provisions of Companies Act, seek for winding up of the company, and once you approach the High Court and obtain an order of winding up, the company proceeds on the liquidation being vested with the official liquidator attached to the High Court. So therefore, on a question of inability to pay, Companies Act steps in, a winding up order is passed, winding up order leads to liquidation of the assets. Now, we all know the experience, if you go and have a look at the office of the official liquidator, huge cases got piled up as regarding this liquidation process. The taking of control of the assets by the liquidator himself was taking years together, and ultimately looking at sale of these assets and distribution of these proceeds to the creditors had become an Herculean task. Now, likewise, and ultimately, if liquidation is happening in a company, it has to end with a dissolution. Likewise, in cases of individuals who are trying their entrepreneur skills in partnership business or sole proprietorship businesses, and if they had an issue of their inability to pay, rather it was looked at a mismatch on the assets and liabilities. This was famously known as the balance sheet method. The regime under the Companies Act and the insolvency of individuals, which were covered by Provincial Insolvency Act and Presidency Towns Insolvency Act. And if you see the years, it is of the year 1919 and 1920. So one of the oldest law as regarding insolvency was regulated through legislations. And in cases of individuals, you will all agree with my view that it was always looked as a stigma. A failure on a commercial realm, a failure of a business by an individual and resulting in an insolvency was looked down in the society and it was seen as a stigma. Like I said, in the case of Companies Act, where the official liquidator is vested with all powers as to the liquidation and ultimate dissolution, in cases of individuals, the insolvent's assets vested with the official assignee, as far as the metropolitan cities are concerned, attached to the high courts, and in other cases, the official receiver. Now, they were vested with rights to take custody of all assets, ensure a proper distribution of the same between the creditors, and the individual should be provided a way out by means of a discharge order. So this was what is in place when this enactment, namely IBC, came into place in 2016. Now, all these... Now, apart from these areas, there was a lot of economic activity happening in terms of liberalization. And you all know that throughout the world, modern insolvency laws started playing a major role in terms of resolutions and reconstructions of companies which were paying issues of insolvencies. Earliest is that you can find in 1970s, the Chapter 11 of US Bankruptcy Code. Then you can find the insolvency law of UK in 1986. So they were all far ahead of us. Now, in terms of economic liberalization, which was happening, there was an urgent need to address these issues. So why this urgent need is that as and when an economic growth happens, there is a lot of credit which is happening, lot of role for the banks and financial institutions, and even individual financiers. When you look at individuals who have been doing business in the nook and corner of the country, they were not within the realm of an institutional framework. They were even looking at taking loans from individuals. That is how you have a lot of these individual credits happening. I mean, all these things, with the economic opening of liberalization, the requirement was that how to address these issues. There may be cases of genuine failures in business. There may be a bona fide defaulter who is in trouble. So you have to give him a way out. Now, studies showed that this insolvency resolution, either be of corporates or individuals, was taking a minimum of 4 years as far as India is concerned. This is what is the report of a world body. Now, as against this, they point out in Singapore, it was 8 months. It is 0.8 year. In UK, it was 1 year. So in all those terms, they had established a fact that India was lacking far behind as regarding early resolutions of these difficulties. So therefore, the government thought fit that there is a requirement of consolidation. So when we think about a new law coming into place, we may also have to have a look at what kind of framework and the law which was in place. I will just put across a slide to show you that these were all the frameworks and laws which were in place. Just have a look at, see, when this insolvency IBC came into place, these were the statutes and other systems which were in place. for individual partnership, for insolvency resolution, you have to look at the Presidency Towns Insolvency Act and Provincial Insolvency Act. For corporates, for revival and rehabilitation, you had Companies Act. We are talking about revival and rehabilitation. I did not say about winding up. Then you had the Sikh Industries, Sikh Industrial Companies Special Provisions Act 1986, SICA. Then you had a liquidation process for corporates under the Companies Act. Then you had debt recovery out of process schemes, which were brought in by Reserve Bank of India, which were commonly known as corporate debt restructuring, joint lenders forums, strategic debt restructuring, scheme for systematic structuring of stressed assets. Then came the debt recovery law in 1993, which enabled the banks and financial institutions to approach the tribunals for having a early resolution in respect of their debts to be recovered. So these were all in place. Now this all had to be consolidated and a legislation was to be brought in. Therefore, experts were put in place by way of a committee asking them to submit reports, and ultimately the government came forward with this Insolvency and Bankruptcy Code. Now this Insolvency and Bankruptcy Code deals with corporate insolvency and insolvency of individuals, including partnership firms. Now, other than that, what is that the code provides for? As a broad outline, if you look at it, the code provides for an institutional mechanism. For the first time, the code provided for an institutional mechanism for this insolvency resolution. Now, in terms of the earlier regimes, the enactments which I have pointed out, you will appreciate the fact whenever there was an act seeking for the insolvency resolution, the situation was such that the debtor, he may be a bona fide debtor or he may be a debtor in willful default, or an individual who was trying to get over certain dubious acts of him by putting across an insolvency proceedings, were all in possession of their assets, their business, everything. So two things I pointed out. Earlier regime, I said, it was looked at inability to pay. So therefore, it was a balance sheet driven. If you have assets, you have liabilities. If your liabilities are far excess of your assets, there is a situation of insolvency. Then secondly, I say, that regime, that earlier enactments provided that the debtor was in possession. This had been a major failure in as so far as SICA is concerned. Under the SICA, the scheme was that a BAFR, a Board of Industrial Finance and Restructuring, was put in place. So any company which was facing a sickness was to report to the BAFR, take a benefit of a standstill situation, no enforcement. You know Section 22 of SICA, which will stall all proceedings, legal proceedings, contracts, everything. So a standstill situation was given, so that the unit rehabilitates itself, the business rehabilitates itself and proceeds forward for a better future. No, but this failed. You have one or two judgments of the Honorable High Court as well as Supreme Court. More particularly, you can look at one full bench decision of the Madras High Court in the case of Salem Textiles versus Phoenix, where the full bench had recorded the fact that there was a huge failure as far as SICA is concerned. Now, in this huge failure, the reasons behind that is that the debtor was in possession. Having taken a benefit of the entire stay of proceedings, keeping the creditors at bay, the debtor was running the unit for years together without any accountability and so forth. So therefore, two things. Debtor in possession was one situation, and liability based on balance sheet is the other situation. Now, IBC, when it came into force, dislodged this entire two things. From the debtor in possession, the very object of the code is that they wanted creditor in control of the situation. The moment there is an insolvency to be resolved, the moment there is a case for a liquidation or a bankruptcy of individual, the code wanted the creditor to be in control. Now, when we speak about creditor to be in control, our own experience as lawyers would show that there had been always arbitrary, discriminatory actions by creditors. which you can even find up to decisions in Supreme Court, where they have come down heavily. One reason is that you don't have a statutory provisions in respect of lender's liability. And most of this lending is driven by contractual obligations. I mean, these cases, so therefore, when creditor is sought to be put possession, the court seeks to address the issue as to whether these creditors can be fully put in control or what kind of professionalism can be brought in within the system. Therefore, the code as a major restructuring proposal or as a major reforms in the laws of insolvency establishes a regulator, namely Insolvency and Bankruptcy Board of India, IBBI. So the code seeks to establish and have a regulator, namely IBBI. Then how to drive the system? IBBA is put in place, which is going to be a board, which will have certain regulatory powers. Now, how to drive the system? Now, debtor is going to be divested of his possession. So we don't want a debtor in possession situation. No, creditor in control. Now, can the creditor run the business or can the creditor take all the steps to get in all the assets and ensure management of the affairs for a easy resolution? Now, for that, the code envisages professionals to get into it, and that professionals are called as insolvency professionals. Therefore, the code paved way for a new professional activity being carried out throughout the country, which is called as insolvency professionals. Now, to regulate these insolvency professionals, the code provides that they need to be having required qualifications. Then it specifies certain eligibility, and above all, they have to undergo a process of testing their ability and then getting a registration with the IBBI. So how to regulate all these things? The code again provided a concept called insolvency professional agency. So for each of these insolvency professionals, there is an agency which is created, and agency monitors, supervises the activities of the insolvency professionals. Then what kind of adjudicatory mechanism? Whenever there is an enforcement under a provision of law, you need to provide for reliefs or the grievance redressal mechanism or adjudication. Now, what is the adjudicatory mechanism it has provided? It provides for an adjudicatory mechanism in the nature of adjudicating authorities. Now, as I said, two different areas are there: insolvency resolution of corporates, likewise insolvency of individuals. Now, does the code provide different adjudicatory mechanism for both of it? Yes, it provides. For corporates, the adjudicating authority is the NCLT and the appellate authority is the NCLAT, and a further appeal is provided to the Honorable Supreme Court. Now, in case of individuals and partnership firms, the adjudicating authority is the DRT and the appellate authority is the DRAT, and likewise an appeal to the Honorable Supreme Court of India. So this is the judicial review process which is provided under the statute. So as it is, if you find the innovation as far as this statute IBC is concerned, it brings in an institutional mechanism in the nature of a regulator, a professional, namely insolvency professional, and a mechanism to monitor this insolvency professional in the nature of insolvency professional agency. Then it speaks of adjudicating authority. Now, in addition to that, does the code provide for any other things? Now, when we speak about insolvency of individuals or corporates, we are effectively looking at the situation of the credit monitoring which is to happen. We are looking at, as I said, from the debtor in possession, it becomes creditor in control. Then I said earlier concept was that balance sheet based inability to be looked into. Now, what did the code provide for? It varied from that situation, and this brings in a new era of liability-based insolvency. Now, what they are looking at is only a debt and default. It in one way, I don't know to say, experience may have to tell us whether it is beneficial or whether it is destructive. But fact remains today, with 4 years of experience in the implementation of this IBC, all insolvency processes or the resolution process is initiated as against corporates based on debt and default. So this is only on the liability. If there is a debt payable by a corporate and if there is a default of such debt, yes, initiate an insolvency resolution is the situation today. So therefore, it is on the credit basis. It is on the information regarding the credit. What is that information? What is the debt which a company today has to service? Or is there a default of such debt? So for this area, the code provides an institutional mechanism called information utility. It is nothing but a credit database. As you all aware, with the present day system of banking or financial institutions, whenever you go and ask for a loan, they ask you what is your CIBIL score. It is nothing but a credit rating of every individual. So likewise, a credit database is sought to be created, and the institution which will have a say on this is called an information utility. Now, after the code came into place, there had been various amendments on various aspects. As I take you through on the further session, I will be also able to explain certain things. This credit rating agency, namely information utility, is also expanded to the extent that today they are looking at every aspect of a business. Like today, if you take a loan for a business, or if you avail a service, or if you purchase a goods on credit, this will again be reported to that information utility. Now that information utility will maintain all the records. So therefore, a situation is created where anybody can have a transparency. They can go back to the information utility, seek to get those details, and based on that, assess what is the situation today is prevailing. Now these are all the an institutional mechanism which the code seeks to address. Now, as I proceed, one thing what I was looking is that the organizers of the session had given me a topic as introduction to IBC. I am not getting into the very nuances and niceties of the act because there are so many things which is happening. As I was preparing myself to have certain short notes for the session, I found that that itself was running to about a few pages. So therefore, what I thought is that I assume that this session is meant for the junior members at the bar. For some moment, I assume that the seniors who are part of it or the judicial officers and the honorable judges are not existing, so that they don't get disappointed as to the expectation which they have on this topic. I am only looking at a very broad side view of an introduction to the IBC. And at the end of the day, if the participant of the session is able to get some interest and look into the act, that will be an achievement which I am looking through, because the code is so exhaustive. It is in terms of provisions also, if I have to take you through everything, it is going to be a long session and we don't have time for such things. So with these things, now let us get into what the code provides. If I can be provided with the sharing, I can take you through the, just hold on for a moment, I will take you through the slide as to one or two aspects. Now, I am taking you into the code. Now, how the scheme of the code? As I said, debt and default is now the driving factors. Therefore, we will have a small look at a few definitions which is available. Now, section 3 of the code provides a certain definitions. And the scheme of the code is such that part 2, which starts with section 4, is on the corporate insolvency resolution. Then part 3, which starts from say section 78 onwards, is on the individual insolvency. As a matter of fact, today that individual insolvency is not yet been notified. Part 2 is alone notified, and a part of part 3 is notified, which relates to personal guarantors to corporate debtor. I will try to explain that also. Then from part 4 onwards, you have all other things. So within this initial definition under section 3, please note three definitions. One is debt. Section 311 defines debt means a liability or obligation in respect of a claim. I have highlighted and underlined these words, in respect of a claim, which is due from any person and includes a financial debt or operational debt. Now, therefore, what is claim has to be seen. Now, claim is defined under Section 3, Subsection 6 as claim means just to spend some time with a clear concentration onto these words, because it seemed very unassuming and interesting for me. And this gives a lot of scope in the coming years as far as this code is concerned. Claim means a right to payment, whether or not such right is reduced to judgment. You see the words fixed, disputed, undisputed, legal, equitable, secured, and unsecured. And likewise, right to remedy for breach of contract and any law for the time being in force, if such breach gives rise to a right to payment, whether or not so and so. Same words are repeated. So when they speak about claim, they are encompassing within that word all nature of claims. It may be a disputed, it may be an undisputed, it may be a secured, unsecured. And interestingly, they say legal, equitable. So all these claims are all these things which qualify to be a claim. And any liability or obligation arising out of such claim is seen as a debt. So therefore, your traditional understanding of a debt is completely brought down. There is a specific definition. Now, please look at default. Default means non-payment of debt when whole or any part or installment of the amount of debt has become due and payable and is not paid by the debtor or the corporate debtor, as the case may be. So therefore, of a non-payment of debt, default happens. So this is on the primary side, which I thought. Other than this, there are various definitions which you need to go through once, bring it to your mind, think about it. As I said, even in terms of creditors, the code brings in certain new concepts which were not in the law books as of now. For example, creditors are classified as financial creditors and operational creditors. So financial debt and operational debt. The definition of financial debt is very exhaustive, and operational debt says in respect of goods and services alone. So this takes into it so many various other things. So now with this, let us get into the other part of the code, which is part two relating to corporate insolvency resolution. Now how the scheme unfolds, what it actually says. As I said, financial creditors and operational creditors are two categories as far as this corporate insolvency resolution is concerned. Now what the code envisages is that if there is a debt and default, the initiation of this corporate insolvency can be done. How this initiation has happened is by filing an application before the adjudicating authority. As I said earlier, the adjudicating authority in respect of corporate insolvency is the NCLT. Now, when you initiate a process against a company for a debt and default, and that corporate is defined as a corporate debtor. So therefore, an application can be filed before the NCLT as against a corporate debtor for initiation of a corporate insolvency resolution process. Now, who can do it? A financial creditor can do it. Section 7 provides that a financial creditor can do it. Now, interestingly, if you look at it, the Act is implemented by virtue of the provisions of the enactment, and it also provides for rules being framed by the government. Rule-making power is provided. And interestingly, it also provides for regulations by the regulator, namely the IBBI. So therefore, the regulations of the IBBI, the rules by the government, and at times even the notifications by the government are all part of the provisions which we have to look into for the purpose of invoking the code. Now, when I said rules, regulations, and notifications, the simple, for a junior purpose, for a junior advocate's point of view, as you read the section, wherever it says prescribed, it means rules. Wherever it says specified, it means regulations. Wherever it says notified, it means notification of the government. So this is a small understanding as to which steps in at what stage. Now, for initiation under Section 7, rules provide what is the format. All these pleadings, putting into a lot of paragraphs, explaining things are all given a go-by. As many statutes which come in, more particularly in the economic laws, it is all in the nature of a question and answer. You have a tabulation, and there is one side of what you have to provide for a question, and the tabulation other side you have to answer that. So therefore, it is a very simplified format, but of course, you have to get into the necessities of it. As I said, invariably the necessity is that you have to establish a debt and default. When you speak about a debt, you have to establish what is a financial document which shows that there is a debt in existence. So these, then when it is a default, you may have to look at what is the document which is available with the information utility and provide that to ensure that there is a debt. So therefore, a financial creditor can initiate under Section 7. He has to file a required application in terms of the format. Now, he doesn't require to give any notice. There is no requirement of even putting the corporate debtor on notice that I want to initiate. So far as he is able to show that there is a debt in default, he directly approaches the NCLT, files an application. Now, in terms of the original provisions, as it is, if you see the provision, he doesn't even speak about any adjudication. Once this application is filed, the NCLT has to satisfy as to whatever has been provided in the application and the documents attached. Once it is satisfied, it can go ahead and admit. So this went to a issue being raised up to the Honorable Supreme Court, and Supreme Court said, on a basic principles of natural justice, it requires that you have to put the corporate debtor on notice, hear him as to anything which they have to say on the debt and default. So this is a very minimum requirement which they have looked into. For a financial creditor to initiate, no notice is required, he directly initiates. Then the second category is an operational creditor. For an operational creditor, the code requires that he has to issue at the first instance a demand notice. That is in Section 8. And a format of demand notice is also provided in the rules. So in terms of the format of the demand notice with minimum required documents, he puts the corporate debtor on notice that there is a debt and default, and very, very short period of time is given. Within that time period, he has to either discharge or show to the person that there is no operational debt or the operational debt has been already discharged. These are the only areas. Now the provision says that he has to in fact effectively show that if there is a dispute, on such dispute, existence of a civil suit or an arbitration proceedings. So it says only if there had been a pre-existing suit and arbitration proceedings on a dispute, you can even raise an issue about the dispute. But however, the Supreme Court came in aid by an interpretation and said that if there is a possible dispute for consideration, NCLT will look into it. So with this notice and non-compliance of this notice, the operational creditor invokes the provisions and initiates the process. This is under Section 9. Then it also provides for initiation under Section 10 by a person called corporate person. This corporate person includes the corporate debtor. The company itself can also file a petition application seeking for initiation of the corporate insolvency resolution, or the directors of the company or the promoters or persons in charge of the superintendents and carrying over of the business. It qualifies the provision space, who is, the definition says who is a corporate person. There are various categories. So all these people can invoke Section 10. So these are under the three provisions, a corporate insolvency resolution can be commenced. Now, once this petition is admitted by the NCLT, it is known as a CIRP commencement, that is Corporate Insolvency Resolution Process Commencement. But what is the consequences of this commencement? The admission order of the NCLT will in fact declare that there will be a moratorium. In terms of Section 14, a moratorium comes into place immediately. Then it provides that an interim resolution professional will be appointed. These insolvency professionals, the registered insolvency professionals, any one of them will be appointed as an interim resolution professional. Now, there is a very, very strict timelines as far as this code is concerned. One of the other basic feature as for the code is that it seeks to achieve everything within a time frame. So therefore, the code initially said once the application is filed within 7 days, the NCLT has to decide. But this has been again watered down, being not in directory in nature. So NCLT takes its time. But still, from our traditional courts, all these timelines have been brought down. I will only point out to one tabulation which is available in the regulations, which says what are the timelines. If you see as a practicing lawyers, it will be very surprising for us. It speaks about 3 days, 7 days, 10 days. This is how it goes. Therefore, an admission, once it is made by the NCLT, there is a paper publication requirement to be made. The interim resolution professional who is appointed will take over the entire management of the corporate debtor. All rights will vest with him. He is required to take into his custody all the assets of the corporate debtor. Then he has to call for claims from all persons. Now these claims can come from financial creditors, claims can come from operational creditors, and claims can come also from other creditors. For each of them, the regulation of IBBI provides as to what is the nature of form which each of the creditor has to use and he has to submit before the interim resolution professional. Now with these claims being collated, we cannot even think about time like an official liquidator was taking adjudication of claims over a period of 4 years, 5 years. You have cases even up to 10 years and adjudication of claims have not happened before the official liquidator. But here under the code, it doesn't speak of adjudication. It speaks about collation of claims. So the claims are collated and within that period of 15 days, the interim resolution professional has to put across what are all the claims he has received. Now on these claims which he has received, he will categorize as financial creditors, operational creditors and other creditors. Now these financial creditors will form a body called Committee of Creditors, COC, it is shortly called a COC. They become the driver from that point of time as to the completion of this entire CIRP process and ensuring the insolvency resolution of the company. So therefore, a COC comes into place, specific rights, obligations, everything has been provided to the COC. The members of the COC are only the financial creditors. They have a voting right percentage in terms of their debt. So the code at different places speaks about different acts to be done by the COC, and such acts, when it has to be put to vote and a decision to be taken, what is the percentage which is required to muster the decision. So all these things are provided. Therefore, this becomes an important aspect. Now, once the COC comes into place, COC can continue with the interim resolution professional, or they can seek for a change of a insolvency professional by having a permanent resolution professional. From there on, the process has to go on. The code says within 180 days, the insolvency resolution of the corporate debtor has to come to an end. This is section 12. Then it says, in situations where it is not possible to have it within 180 days, it says there can be a further extension of 90 days. Therefore, it goes up to only 270 days. Now, various cases which were undergoing the CIRP had gone through litigations up to Supreme Court, carrying the process from the NCLT to NCLAT and to Supreme Court. So there were time periods which were lost in these litigations. Therefore, the tribunal started interpreting, saying that there will be exclusion of periods. If there is a period which is lost in a litigation without further process, therefore an exclusion was considered. Now, this was also sought to be put to an end by the government by bringing in an amendment. And ultimately, today, as the law stands, it says that even including the proceedings before the adjudicating authority and the appellate authority and the courts, the entire process has to be completed within 330 days. Now, what has to be done within this period of either 180 or 270 or 330 is that the insolvency professional, that is the resolution professional, he has to take control of the entire assets. He has to get all the claims. Based on that, he has to get a valuation of these assets. And he will further proceed with finalizing a document called Information Memorandum. It is called IM. So the resolution professional will finalize an IM. And he will keep updating all these details to the Committee of Creditors to the extent required. And the code at many places provides for lots of confidentiality to be maintained. He doesn't want everything to be known to everybody at all points of time. Now, with these things, the Committee of Creditors have to make an assessment as to whether this company can be put into some rehabilitation or restructuring or a resolution, for which they have to call for interest of any person for submitting a plan called resolution plan. So the COC will drive for calling a resolution plan, and a person who submits a resolution plan is called a resolution applicant. So regulations are there, provisions of the code is there, which says what are all the mandatory requirements of a resolution plan and what are all the tests which has to be adopted in considering a resolution plan. So assume a situation that some third party comes in and submits a resolution plan, that will be considered by the COC, and on based on a voting, they approve the resolution plan or they reject the resolution plan. Now, if in case of rejection, it goes to the NCLT for a order on liquidation. Now, this RP becomes a liquidator and the company goes for a liquidation. In cases of resolution plan being approved, the resolution professional has to take it further forward to the adjudicating authority for having the resolution plan approved. Now, again, the adjudicating authority has to look into whether the resolution plan complies with all the provisions of the code as well as the regulations. Now, there were so much of jurisprudence on this issue saying that certain stakeholders' rights are not considered. Situation like the resolution plan has to satisfy all the financial criteria. Only if there is surplus, it goes to the operational criteria. Therefore, operational criteria were being left out. Of course, the code addresses in section 53 as to how the distribution has to happen in case of liquidation, which is called a waterfall mechanism. So similar thing is also adapted. Suppose in a liquidation, if there is a chance of an operational creditor getting paid after the financial creditor is being paid, to that extent, the resolution plan also has to make a provision. It cannot leave out an operational creditor completely when he has got an opportunity of getting paid in a liquidation. So all these checks and balances are provided in the provision. So NCLT ultimately has to decide. So jurisprudence, which I was talking about, is that certain plans were tested saying that it discriminates the operational creditors, it discriminates among the secured creditors, among the financial creditors. So all these things again went up to the Supreme Court, and Supreme Court with two or three decisions made it very clear that the decision of the COC is final. It says that the NCLT can look into the plan only in terms of the statutory requirements under the provisions and regulations. The commercial wisdom which the COC puts in approving a plan cannot be tested. So this is all the resolution. As I said, it has to happen within this period. Now, during this period, as I pointed out, there is going to be a complete moratorium. No proceedings can go on. All proceedings get stalled. No initiation of any proceedings against the company. Then no enforcement of any contracts or anything. There will be a complete moratorium during this CIRP period. Now, when we speak about complete moratorium, therefore, any person who has a claim, all claims has to come before the RP. And all those claims has to be addressed in the resolution plan. Now, ultimately, if a resolution plan is approved by the COC and then approved by the NCLT as an adjudicating authority, that becomes final and binding on all persons. Now, this is also concerning the workmen, employees, statutory dues. Now, one area, if you see, you can even get into the very preamble of the enactment and objects. I will just point out now at this stage. I'll go through further and I'll point out to that also. So, therefore, all claims of the government, everything has to be addressed within this scheme as to the resolution plan which comes into it. It cannot travel beyond it. Now, having said that, if there had been some issues like claims which the company has to recover or certain claims which are to defraud the rights of the creditors, whether there is any provision under the code provides for all those things. The adjudicating authority is vested with all powers. And the resolution professional has to decimate all these information. And there is a time limit again. It can be only for a period of 1 year or 2 years prior to the commencement of the CIRP. Now, those are also specifically provided under the code. It speaks about preferential transaction. It speaks about avoidance transaction. It speaks about fraudulent transaction. Then it speaks about extortionate credit transaction. Like one creditor has provided with an interest rate of 24%, 36%, whereas the other creditor is at 12%. Then one creditor is provided with a specific security within this period of 2 years in preference to the other creditor. So all those things can also be tested and adjudicated. And the provisions are there to bring back assets or money, whichever is involved in terms of these transactions. So therefore, as in the earlier case of Companies Act, where certain transactions were tested, the code makes it more wider, and all such issues has to be part of the CIRP. And this is also part of the liquidation if it goes for a liquidation. So therefore, one specific provision, if you take note of, is Section 60 speaks about the adjudicating authority. Section 60 is the enabling provision by which the DRT is named as the adjudicating authority for the corporate insolvency resolution process. Now, in Section 60, subsection 5 says that all issues on questions of law and fact which are arising in respect of a corporate debtor in the process of the corporate insolvency resolution shall be decided by the NCLT. So therefore, all issues has to be brought before the NCLT, and the NCLT is vested with all such powers. Now, having said this, one area which the resolution happens is in terms of a resolution plan being approved. Now, certain issues which came up is that who can submit a resolution plan. So initially, the code was silent about it. Therefore, even a defaulting promoters were coming forward with resolution plans, which will show almost 50% of the liability. Suppose the company had about 100 crores liability, they gave a resolution plan saying that 50 crores will be paid and permit me to run the company. So this was again not liked by the creditors, and it was also looked into a backdoor method of the same defaulting promoters getting into the companies. Therefore, amendments came, section 29A came, which said that persons who are in default, who are declared as defaulters, they cannot submit a resolution plan. Then an exemption came to this in terms of micro, small and medium scale industries, MSME industries. They were given a kind of concession saying that they can submit resolution plan, because that was a priority area which the government wanted to work on. So these are all persons who can be a resolution applicant. In fact, there is more which I said. As I said, if I have to take through, it will take a longer time. I am giving some insights which will ultimately give you, will bring in some interest on you to go through the provisions. So you can take all time to read through those provisions and get into it. So resolution happens. Now, resolution plan is binding on all the persons. Now, corporate debtor continues to proceed. Now, till this period, this 180, 270 days, what happens? Now, one thing which the code addresses is that the company, if it is a going concern, has to be kept as a going concern. So there is a standstill period. There is a moratorium. Unlike the earlier regime, everything is not brought to an end. So the resolution professional is vested with the right to carry on the business. For essential services, he can continue to honor the contracts which are there. For example, if there is a supply of goods which is happening for the company to run, and if it has to run to this period. So the company is kept in a condition where it keeps on going, it does not get into a situation of being redundant. So this is also one obligation. The COC is also required. So it provides for interim finance raising and how it has to be addressed, bank accounts to be operated. But whatever it is, the directors are treated as suspended directors and they don't have a say. The RP has and the COC has. Now, if this resolution doesn't happen, the other area which the code provides is liquidation. Liquidation can happen if there is no resolution plan which is coming forth within the statutory period. Or the statutory period is over, which I said 180, 270 or 330 is over without any resolution plan being considered. Or if there is a case of a resolution plan being rejected by the COC or the adjudicating authority, then there will be a situation of the resolution plan having been put in place, but it ends up in a failure. Now, apart from all these things, there is also a situation where the committee of creditors, even before the period coming to an end, make a decision that there is no scope for any restructuring or rescheduling or reconstruction of the company, and therefore the resolution of the company. Therefore, they provide, they in their wisdom think that the company has to go for a liquidation. Then also liquidation order. So on all these situations, the RP brings it before the adjudicating authority seeking for an order of liquidation. Now the code extensively deals with the liquidation process. Regulations are there in place as regarding this liquidation process. Now in the liquidation, the resolution professional who was managing as the insolvency professional who was managing as the resolution professional becomes the liquidator. Now he takes care of all the assets. Then he looks forward to sale of these assets. As I said, one important provision as far as the liquidation is concerned, section 53, which is called as a waterfall mechanism. Now section 63 says on which manner the priority has to be decided. In fact, it dislodges all priorities which were in existence, more particularly in cases of government dues, statutory dues, all fall in the last category. Now having, this is on one thing. Then in the liquidation process also, the liquidator is empowered to petition the adjudicating authority seeking for determination of certain transactions. As I said, fraudulent transactions, avoidance transactions, all those transactions can be again tested before the adjudicating authority, and orders can be obtained to get back the assets of the corporate debtor. So with that, a liquidation estate is created, and on the sale process, the liquidation. Interestingly, the code as well as the judgments up to the Supreme Court as well as NCLAT has provided, even at the liquidation stage, it can be sold as a going concern. The company can be sold as a going concern. So that provision is also there. In fact, NCLAT had expanded it further and said that even at the liquidation stage, by invoking the provisions of Companies Act, the promoters or some other person can come forward with a scheme of arrangement. as to how he wants to discharge the debts and take over the company and run it. So this is all on the jurisprudence which is available in respect of the corporate insolvency resolution process. One thing which I have to point as to much of jurisprudence which has evolved is that companies which were doing on real estate business, when they went into this issue of CIRP or the liquidation, issues came as to how the home buyers has to be addressed. So this has happened in a big scale in the North India when you had huge builders which had brought before the NCLTs for going through the CIRP. Now, originally in terms of the provisions, these home buyers did not have a particular area in which a claim can be made. So they all petitioned the IBBI and said that as what we have to make a claim, what is the form which we have to make for a claim? I also have a stake, I have a stakeholder. Initially the IBBI said that you can make a claim as other creditors. Then that was not taken into in the case of Chitra Sharma versus Union of India. The person went before the Supreme Court invoking Article 32 and said that there is a huge discrimination and it is going to lead to a very catastrophic situation where the home buyers are going to be left high and dry. So that case was taken up by the Supreme Court and it wanted the government to address the situation. Later, by an amendment, home buyers were also recognized as financial creditors. Now, having come into that situation, home buyers were huge in numbers. And the government had also looked into a situation where certain finance creditors can be a class of creditors. Therefore, amendments provided that the financial creditors can be represented as a class and they can be represented by an authorized representative in the committee of creditors. So these all these issues have been addressed. Now, once I say about all these things, I also need to point out at this stage, there is a challenge to the enactment, which you are aware, which went up to the Supreme Court. And in the case of the Swiss Ribbons versus Union of India, Supreme Court upheld this enactment. Now, interestingly, in this judgment, which is an interesting read, which all of you can also go through it, the Supreme Court adopted a different interpretation tools. When a statute is being interpreted, you know that there are various tools of interpretation which is applied. Now, Supreme Court applied a different. It looked into judicial review versus economic reforms or judicial review versus economic loss. This was the heading which was given. And they went into a point saying that it is an experimental activity of a legislature which needs to be supported by the judiciary, for which the Honorable Supreme Court relied upon various judgments of US courts, which were initially dissent judgments, and after a period of time with the economic activities, with the economic scenario changing, these dissent judgments become majority judgments. And in those lines, the Supreme Court said, as far as this act is concerned, this code is concerned, there is a lot of things which are happening. The government is akin to the realities and they have brought in various amendments. So that was welcomed. So therefore they said, let us give a chance to the government to experiment and make out the code in a better way. So this is one area which a lot of jurisprudence which has arisen as far as this code is concerned. So having said about the corporate insolvency resolution process, now the next area is the insolvency resolution of individuals. As I said, that part 3 is not yet fully notified. So let me not spend much of the time. I will only give an insight. But one area of that part 3 is now brought into action. That is cases where individuals standing as personal guarantors for corporate debtor. This is specifically addressed in the code, which says if there is a company which is undergoing a CIRP process, you know the adjudicating authority is NCLT. Suppose for the same company's debt, if there is a personal guarantor, namely the individuals, directors or promoters, if something has to be initiated as against them in respect of their liability as guarantor, the code says NCLT will have jurisdiction, unlike the jurisdiction of DRTs under part 3. Now this is being notified. Therefore, the individual personal guarantors can also be proceeded with. Now this comes with a situation where if a personal guarantor is sought to be proceeded, and there is no proceedings initiated against the company. So the corporate debtor is not before the NCLT. There is no CIRP initiated. But a creditor wants to proceed against the personal guarantor. Then he will invoke the jurisdiction of DRT, which is as on date, is notified and it's available. So therefore, cases like that as against personal guarantors, the jurisdiction of DRT and DRAT will be applicable. And the same process in terms of part 3 will be made applicable. Specific rules for that process is been notified. Specific regulations have also come into place. So this is on the areas which today it's already in place. Now let us see the part 3, personal individuals. insolvency as regarding individuals. Now, interestingly, in part 3, again, it provides for specific definitions under section 78. Then the first provision, the first chapter of part 3 itself is a unique thing. It says about fresh start. The code provides that in cases of individuals facing insolvency situation, they can invoke the provisions of the code and ask for a fresh start process. They can ask the adjudicating authority where there will be a standstill, a moratorium be declared, and they will be permitted to have a time gap before which they can recoup themselves and initiate. So this is one fresh start, which is a novel thing which is being provided under the code. Now, apart from this fresh start, the process under the individual insolvency is such that, as in the case of corporate insolvency, the debtor himself can file, and which is there even in the earlier statutes which we had. Likewise, a creditor can invoke and he can initiate the process. As I said, it goes before the DRT for the filing for the adjudication process. Now, there, the scheme, how it works out is that the day when the petition is filed, there is an interim moratorium in operation. Immediately on the interim moratorium, an interim resolution professional is appointed. Now, this professional has to, at the first instance, examine this individual debtor, and he has to place a report before the DRT. Now, based on this report, the DRT will take a call whether this insolvency petition has to be admitted or it has to be rejected. So this is one preemptive stage which is looked at. But still, the day the petition is filed, interim moratorium starts kicking in. Now, once the DRT admits the petition and it initiates the insolvency resolution to commence as against the individual, it will provide for appointment of a resolution professional, and it also provides for moratorium. Then, as in the case of corporate debtors, the resolution professional has to call for claims, list out who are all the creditors, take custody of the assets, all those things are there. Now, something different from the earlier statutes are provided in terms of excluded assets, excluded debt. Now, as you know that individual insolvency was the biggest stigma earlier, because all assets will be taken away from you, including a house, including your clothes. Where very commonly they used to say you will be given two sets of clothes, basic utensils and something to make out your life for the food. Beyond that, everything with the official assignment. Now, this code travels further, but it says that you can have a house to a particular value if it is a non-metropolitan area, particular value for a metropolitan area. Then it goes to the extent of even saying that you can have your car, you can have your basic ornaments. Then it says if it is a small business which you are running, you can continue with the business. You can carry on the business to a limited extent. So all these protections are provided. These are all the new things as far as individual insolvency is concerned under the code. Now, once the RP brings in, there is no concept of a committee of creditors here. In the corporate sector, the committee of creditors drive. So there is no such driving force. He only takes care and he only puts the debtor into test by summoning him and by examining him, placing a report. Then the code requires a resolution in the nature of a repayment plan coming forward from the debtor himself. So in an individual insolvency, the debtor has to provide a repayment plan as to all his debts, the manner in which he wants to discharge it. Now, this repayment plan will be scrutinized by the resolution professional, because he, by the time he is in custody of the assets, he knows what the debtor was doing because he has examined, he has placed a report before the DRT. Therefore, he will test as to whether this repayment plan is in accordance with whatever is being provided under the statute, is in accordance with what he was able to examine and get details. With this report, it goes before the creditors. It is actually called as a creditors meeting. It is not a case of committee of creditors. It is a creditors meeting. Now, creditors will take a decision as to whether this repayment plan has to be considered or not. Then if repayment plan is considered and approved by the creditors with a particular voting percentage, it goes to the DRT for an approval, and DRT approves it, and there is a process for discharge of the debtor so that he becomes free, and the manner in which the repayment plan has to be executed. Now, if there is non-compliance of this repayment plan, again, it provides for further consequences follow. Likewise, it also addresses the issue of bankruptcy. Suppose repayment plan is not forthcoming, or repayment plan is not agreeable by the resolution professional, or the repayment plan does not get approved by the meeting of the creditors or the adjudicating authority, the consequential order is for a declaration of bankruptcy of the person. So once bankruptcy is declared, the resolution professional becomes a bankruptcy trustee. Now he again will have all the rights to take possession of all the assets, and he deals with the bankruptcy. At every stage, again, there is timelines. If you just run through a chart, I just made a chart and tried to run through. Everything says 3 days, 5 days, 10 days, 15 days. So likewise, everything is time bound. And this is what the code seeks to achieve, deviating from the earlier regime where we had a very bad experience of a lot of times being spent on the adjudicatory process. So this is on the individual insolvency. Ultimately, the bankruptcy trustee has to bring all the assets for sale and distribution. Again, distribution is provided under the individual insolvency also in a particular provision. Regulations are there. Now, this has not yet been notified except the case of personal guarantors. Now, having said this, then I pointed out earlier the institutional mechanism, namely the IBBA. So, it is an Insolvency and Bankruptcy Board of India. IBBA is vested with huge powers. At one instance, if you say within that five things which I said, IBBA, insolvency professionals, insolvency professional agency, adjudicating authority, and information utility. Now, this information utility, insolvency professional, and insolvency professional agency are all under the management of the IBBA, rather not management. It is all subjected to the regulations of the IBBA. So, all activities of these three persons are regulated by the IBBA. Then, as far as the adjudicating authority is concerned, under the code, it is provided with the specific processes of adjudicating the issues which come up for consideration before them. So therefore, the IBBA plays a major role. It is created as a statutory body with the board members being nominated by government, independently taken into board, and they frame out the mechanism, the roadmap as to how the code has to proceed further. So that is where, wherever issues have come up, IBBA comes up immediately with certain regulations, modifications, amendments, all those things have come into place. Like having said about IBBA, next will be the insolvency professional. Now, interestingly, if you see the eligibility and qualification to become an insolvency professional is vested with four persons. One is the chartered accountants, and all these four persons, they are looking at an experience of minimum 10 years. So persons with 10 years experience from four professionals, namely chartered accountants, company secretaries, cost accountants, and advocates. So these are all the category of persons who are qualified to become an insolvency professional. The experts in this field say that this is a very good new area which is opened up, which gives lot of opportunities. In fact, I had done one session for IBBA exclusively on a point saying that the capacity building exercise of advocates under IBC. Today, as I said, insolvency professional, to become an insolvency professional under the code, qualification experience is there. Now, these people have to be registered with an insolvency professional agency. Unless you are registered with an insolvency professional agency, you are not eligible to take up an examination being conducted by IBBA. So now, what are all the agencies? Now, IBBA has provided regulations as to what bylaws have to be there in the agency, what kind of mechanism of monitoring, supervising these insolvency professionals has to be given. So all, therefore, the agency assumes an important role. Now, for each of these professional, if you see the provision, it says, chartered accountant enrolled with the Institute of Chartered Accountants Association of India. Then company secretaries enrolled with their body, their regulatory body. Then cost accountants are enrolled with the regulatory body. Likewise, advocates enrolled with bar counsel. Now, interesting, which you find is that the insolvency professional agencies have been created by other three professions other than advocates. Today, Bar Council has not gone ahead with the registration of an insolvency professional agency or none of the advocate bodies, whereas the other three bodies have created their own insolvency professional agencies today. But of course, there are many lawyers who have now become insolvency professionals by undertaking the exam and cleared it. They become member of any of these bodies. They have to register with this body, and through that it happens. So this is one area as an advocate which we can look at in a huge way of capacity building. The reason why I point out with some emphasis on this is that unless we rise to the occasion, there is all possibilities that the other three major professional players is going to have a big say in the code. Now, before the adjudicating authority, as advocates have a say, the chartered accountants, company secretaries are also permitted to have a say. That is provided under the Companies Act and the Company Code rules, which you are aware. Now, as resolution professional, they themselves conduct the cases. So down the line, as a professional, if we have to make a mark in it, it is required that we also have to look into this. So therefore, I address the issue about insolvency professionals, then insolvency professional agency. And last one is the information utility. Now, this information utility is all nothing but credit data bodies or credit rating agencies. As of now, a registered association is that registered body of information utility is NSEL is one registered body of information utility. So it, today, in terms of amendment and regulations, all credit related activities of corporates are bound to be registered with the information utility. Now, correspondingly, changes, amendments were made into other economic laws also to ensure that these information utilities may play a major role. So I have tried to give up a broad outline. I will now try to run through a few slides only for the purpose of understanding as to what I said or the emphasis which it brings about. And with that, maybe in another 4 or 5 minutes, I will leave the floor for the persons to raise their queries. Now, let us see a few slides alone, the very same presentation which I made. So as I showed, now one, the need for the code was summarized in these words. Resolution of insolvency and bankruptcy was taking longest time. Debt resolution of different categories were under different laws and forums. Balance sheet test driven and not liquidity driven approach. And there were no early warning systems for resolution. And debtor is in possession was fraught with conflicts in process and risks. And DRT is clogged and so on, so, so, and so. And then this is very important. If you just see the objects with all that I have said about what the code seeks to achieve. Now see the objects of the code. An act to consolidate and amend the laws. This I pointed out. What are all the laws? Now, once the third party is notified, the Provincial Insolvency Act and Presidency Towns Insolvency gets repealed. Then relating to reorganization and insolvency resolution of corporate person, partnership firms and individuals in a time-bound manner. And ultimately, they point out the major object is that for maximization of the value of assets. So in this new code, the emphasis is that we are looking at maximization of value of assets in a insolvency situation, because our past experiences, the moment it goes for an insolvency, you know, companies which went before the official liquidator, nothing survived 10 or 15 years down the line, but for the land value, machineries would have been rotten, buildings would have been depleted. So this was the situation. Now what the code seeks to achieve is maximization of value of assets. Then to promote entrepreneurship, availability of credit, and balance the interest of all stakeholders, including alteration in the order of priority of payment of government dues, and to establish an insolvency and bankruptcy board of India. So the very object speaks about alteration in the order of priority. So this becomes important. Then I pointed out about the innovations in the code. Like I said, IBBA is the apex board, administers the code and valuation professionals in India. Insolvency professionals manage the insolvency resolution process registered under the Chartered Accountants, Cost Accountants, Company Secretaries and Advocates, then agencies, then adjudicating authorities, then information utilities. Now then I took to the other portion. I will only point out to the, see timelines. When I spoke about timelines, Regulation 40A of the IBBA has set out modern timelines for insolvency. Now when I speak about these things, I need to also point out that the code rules and regulations have brought in high professionalism from these insolvency professionals. They have a clear reporting mechanism. Every month the activity has to be reported and it is being monitored. Every report which is sent, I hear from insolvency professionals that queries are raised immediately by IBBA. So there is a separate department sitting on it. Now with this, there is also a situation where there are issues on the integrity or the functioning or the professionalism when it is lax. The code provides for disciplinary action to be taken. So every timeline, even if there is a breach of this timeline, is seen as a professional misconduct, disciplinary activities are taken. So in that context, please see this model timeline. See, Regulation 6.1 says, public announcement inviting claims should happen within 3 days. This timeline T is the commencement. Then you see, submission of claims has to happen within 14 days. Just see that last column, T plus 14. Then submission of claims, maximum is up to 90 days. Then verification of claims is 21 days. Now all these process 97 days it should be over. Then verification of claims received under regulation 12(2). Then application for appointment of authorized representative in case of home buyers and class of creditors 23 days. Then report certifying constitution of COST has to happen within 23 days. So from the date when an admission happens, within 1 month, all these records come to the NCLT as well as the IBBA. Then first meeting of COC has to happen within 30 days. Then please see appointment. Then you just go for valuation, then submission of application, everything. Then please see the resolution plan. For all reliefs, which I said about preferential transaction, everything should happen within 75, 115 and 135. I hope you get that on the screen. Then submission of information memorandum within 54 days. Then invitation of expression of interest, 90 days. Provision of list by the resolution applicants, 100 days. So all in this manner, if you see a timeline is given, which ends at 180. Of course, the court provides an extension of another 90 days. We can go to 270. And then in total, it is 330 days. Then moratorium. Then let me take on, see, these are all the transactions which can be tested. Preferential transaction, avoidance transaction, undervalue transaction, fraudulent transaction, extraordinary credit transaction. Now, when we come to resolution plan, there is regulations. Regulation 37 says, resolution plan shall provide for the measures. What it has to provide? Everything. It can provide for transfer of all or part of the assets of the corporate debtor to one or more persons. So by transfer of the assets of the company, the resolution can be there. Or it says sale of all the part of assets, the resolution can be there. Or restructuring of the corporate debtor by way of merger, amalgamation, demerger, resolution can be there. Then substantial acquisition of shares. So these are all various modes which they say you can give a resolution plan for a company which is facing the corporate insolvency. Then regulation 38 says mandatory contents of resolution plan. It says what are all, at the first instance says operational creditors shall be paid in priority over financial creditors. Then to financial creditors, how the priority has to happen, how the other stakeholders has to be addressed. I'm just rushing through because of the time we don't. Now please see section 53, waterfall mechanism. This is on the distribution in case of liquidation. Same principle is applied also in case when resolution plan is submitted. It says at the first instance, cost of CIRP and liquidation cost to be paid in full. Then pari passu among secured creditors who have relinquished the security and workmen dues for 24 months. So they both have to be paid equally as one category. The secured creditor who have relinquished the security and part of their liquidation and workmen for past 12 months. Then it's past 24 months. Then it says wages of employees other than 12 months. Now when it speaks about waterfall mechanism, the meaning is such that if suppose the entire realized value goes only for A, none of the other people get it. Suppose it goes for B, it stops at B. Suppose the realized amount is able to satisfy only A and B, others don't get it. So this is how it rolls. So wages of employees for 12 months, financial debts to unsecured, then pari passu. So government dues also come much bottom, and it is on pari passu with the secured creditors, unpaid money other than realization, whatever he is not able to realize, it has to go. Then finally it provides for resolution. So incidentally, I did not touch upon this. The code also provides for fast track process. If you want to fast track the process, same 180 days becomes 90 days. So that can be gone into. Then voluntary liquidation is provided. So once the Companies Code Act is not providing for any other provision, all comes under IBC, therefore voluntary liquidation. Then adjudicating authority. Now, the code also provides for certain punishments. Certain penal provisions are there. This is very interesting. See, it says fraudulent or malicious initiation of proceedings can be adjudicated upon by the adjudicating authority under section 65. Then it provides for a fine to be imposed if it is found that there was a malicious initiation. Then it says fraudulent trading or wrongful trading during the insolvency process. Then where there are various punishments for concealment of property. Now all these punishments are penal actions which will go before special court. That is also provided under the code. Then transactions defrauding creditors, misconduct in CIRP, falsification of books, willful and material omission, false representation to creditors, contravention. So likewise, there are also provisions under the individual insolvency. So I think with this we can bring it to an end so that there is enough time for the members to also have raise certain issues. Then at the last portion of it, I have asked the organizers to circulate to me. I have just brought a few judgments, only essential judgments. The Swiss Ribbons judgment is reported in 2019 for SEC 17. And what the Honorable High Supreme Court has held, relevant paragraphs alone, I have just cited. Then powers of committee creditors, committee of creditors was dealt with in Shashidhar versus Indian Overseas Bank. That is decision is 2019-12 SEC 150. Then SR Steels was the latest judgment, 2019-16 scale 319. This is a three judges bench judgment. So these judgments I just provided there so that you can have some insight on it. So with this, with a clear statement that I only tried to give you a very broad introduction to the court, I have not taken you to the entire thing. So therefore, if you had a huge expectation and if I have fallen below that expectation, kindly please excuse me. With the given time, I think I was able to put across to you some interest. Now, one thing which I have to say is that once the insolvency, individual insolvency is also notified, this court becomes a huge driving force as far as litigation is concerned. Even in the corporate cases, we have seen before NCLTs, banks have come, individual suppliers have come, individual service providers have come, workmen have come. There are cases where even landlord-tenant dispute was brought before the NCLT saying that there is a debt due, therefore initiate CIRP. So all these litigations got shifted. Now, unfortunately, as far as legal fraternity or our advocate community is concerned, once somebody brings a brief to you saying that somebody has initiated a process in NCLT, we take it for granted. We have seen where advocates come with a wakalat and say that I'm filing wakalat, you give me a time to file a reply. But if you go through the code, all these things are not provided. Therefore, we should live up to the situation, rise to the occasion, and try to enlighten ourselves with these new laws and carry forward. Ultimately, the implementation of any law is in the hands of advocates, is my strong belief. The moment a law is implemented, it gives the biggest advantage to the legal community because ultimately we look at enforcement of rule of law. Thank you everyone for this long session. And I can now look forward for any queries and anything people want to add to it also, because something which I would have missed it. I had one doubt. This is called as a code. I don't know why it is called as a code. Normally any enactment is called as an act. We know only civil procedure code and criminal procedure code. For some reason, this enactment is called as a code. So even if somebody can tell me why it was called as a code, I'll be happy about it.
Thank you, Mr. Om Prakash, for your wonderful session. I would rather say the clarity and the lucidity in which you have narrated what is called the arrangements is something is very great. And I have no doubt that not even a single person of the webinar would leave with a question mark in his mind, sir. I thank you for that. First of all, I may request Justice Anand Vengadesh to enter with you, sir. Lordship, you can talk to Mr. Elanti, sir.
Good morning, sir.
Good morning, Mr. Om Prakash. One thing which I wanted to share is that the main purpose, the reason why we wanted this IBC to be brought into this webinar series was that I always felt that it has fallen into the exclusive monopoly of the advocates who are practicing in the city side.
Yes.
So basically, I wanted this monopoly to be somehow broken.
100%
because if such monopolization happens, what happens is after a period of time, it paves way for the destruction of the very purpose itself. So
yes,
it's important that it spreads far and wide. And as you rightly say, the moment part 3 is notified, I think it will spread to almost every nook and corner of the state.
Yes.
That's the first reason why we wanted this. Secondly, the ease with which you were able to showed your efficiency over this subject. See, as you must understand, it is 4 years since this was enacted.
Yes.
Many of those things which you said, many of the advocates here who have heard it for the first time.
Yes.
It's 4 year legislation. So therefore, it's very important that we start acclimatizing ourselves into this. And thirdly, as you rightly said, that we have this attitude of using courts for the purpose of postponing our liability, meaning tiring down the other side by using court. Unfortunately, people are approaching court for the purpose of enforcing rights, but it is working the other way around. The other way around is that using the court to tire down the creditor to such an extent that he will just run away. And that is why the Supreme Court once rightly said that the actual litigation starts only after the execution petition is filed. So this attitude is completely broken away by this particular enactment, where, as you rightly said, that an advocate cannot come to the NCLT and say, "I am filing wakala, give me time to file my reply." That's not an attitude which is encouraged by this enactment. Yes. So it is going to bring about a huge change in the very attitude of litigation process when it comes to settlement of liabilities or payment of repayment of debts, etc. So it's very important that the advocates get used to this particular code, because it is going to spread far and wide the moment the part 3 is notified. So thank you so much for your time, Mr. Om Prakash, and it was a very, very useful session for all of us.
Thank you, sir. I will only add two things, sir, from what you have said. One is that when the DRT Act has been amended along with this IBC, where they said the adjudicating authority will be DRT. So they made specific provisions as to the adjudicating powers of the DRTs under the IBC. And in respect of sittings of the DRT, amendment was brought in terms of IBC saying that the DRT proceedings will also have sittings by way of circuit sitting in districts. That provision, once it is notified, has to be brought into effect so that it goes to the districts, it goes to them. Instead of only being at Coimbatore, Madurai and Chennai, it also happened. Now, second thing which I wanted to add is that when I said about this insolvency professional, different professionals. Now, today, this 4 years experience, you can look, there is huge amount of educative information which is being spread by these chartered accountants, company secretaries and cost accountants within their fraternity. They have regular enlightenment programs and study circle programs, everything. But unfortunately, in advocate circle, we have been lacking on this.
See, the problem is that the commercial bent of mind is not there for advocates. I must tell you that. See, you will find the huge difference only because the other three communities about which you are talking, day in and day out, they are exposed only to commercial things.
Correct.
Whereas the life of an advocate is very, very different.
Yes.
In the practice of an advocate, commercial disputes also forms a small portion of it.
Yes.
So therefore, that attitudinal change is very difficult for an advocate, because they deal with a lot of other things. They deal with life, liberty, they deal with all types of issues.
Yes.
So therefore, I don't expect an advocate to really change his attitude to the extent to which a chartered accountant or a cost accountant or a company secretary will do it. But as you rightly say, that we have to somehow bring in this culture of involving advocates into it, because it will give a completely a different perspective about the entire resolution profession itself when an advocate handles it.
Thank you, sir. Thank you very much.
Thank you.
Thank you, Lordship. Question by one Mr. R.K. Iranjaliyan. Mr. Iranjaliyan,
yes. Yes.
We can talk to Mr. Iranjaliyan.
Sir, good afternoon, sir.
Good afternoon, sir.
So you have enlightened me, sir. I'm just running through this court for more than 6 months. I'm just getting myself comfort, but this time it really made me very clear in some aspects. Sir, I have got two clarification from this one.
Yes, sir.
During the process of CRP, but there is only one, only one financial creditor. Okay. In this situation, when the credit debtor himself gives an option that to settle the issue during the process, it is possible, sir.
Yes, sir, it is possible. Earlier, it was not there. By an amendment, section 12A is being brought into it. So, wherever possibilities of settlements are there, tribunals and courts are also a bit liberal on that. Amendment itself is brought. 12A is there today. In terms of section 12A, during the process, if there is a settlement which is arrived, that can be acted upon, reported to the NCLT, and the process can be brought to an end.
So it has to be taken to RP and through him to NCLT,
or
we can directly go to the creditor?
So you have to get an arrangement with the creditor, and ultimately the creditor has to agree to the passing of a resolution saying that matters are getting settled. Therefore, we want to bring an end to the CIRP. That resolution will be carried by the RP to the NCLT to bring an end to the process.
Okay, sir. So the next question is that.
Yes.
So if there is a property which is available for sale or it is with the creditors' vote, if there is a plan of giving a partial property can be sold to a
residential
flat. Do it is possible? Approve it, do it is possible, sir.
It is possible. See, either promoters can also bring in such a scheme, provided they are not disqualified. If they are not disqualified, they can bring in. Suppose if some third party steps in, part of his resolution plan, he can also give it. Primarily, what the code seeks to achieve is that there should be maximization of assets and ultimately restructuring of the company, and the corporate debtor should be permitted to survive and carry on its business. If for some reason, by only sale, there is a possibility of resolution, and the balance, the property, balance properties or whatever balance business can carry on effectively, that is also possible. There is no bar to that.
Okay, sir. Thank you very much, sir. Thank you,
Mr. Engineer. You can unmute yourself so that I can go to other parties.
Sure.
Unmute yourself.
Yeah.
So next to Mr. Dinesh Nair. Mr. Dinesh Nair, you can talk to Mr. Alant.
Yes, sir. Good morning, sir.
Morning, sir.
Thank you very much for your valuable, you are enlightened us. Sir, I have only one request to you, sir.
Yes.
You can throw some light to the young advocates.
Yes.
They can go for this insolvency professionals.
Yes.
Or bankruptcy professional, whatever it is.
Yes.
And also, our organizer, Srinivasa Raghavan, sir, also can help.
Yes, sir. Yes.
Mr. Dinesh, sir, I think already we have decided to do something more in this field. We will come out with an announcement very shorter in which Mr. Elante will play a pivotal role.
Yes, sir. Yes, sir. Definitely. Definitely. Because it is a grey field. It is a grey field.
Sure.
Most of our brothers are not aware of that thing.
Yes.
I think. That is what
sure,
my...
Sir.
Yes, sir. Most are not aware about the enactment, and it requires educating ourselves to a large extent. Then a selected agency to be formed or within the available agencies getting registered and taking up the examination. I find that many of our lawyers who are also trying to take up that examination and get it cleared. And we have a few advocates already as insolvency professionals. So this is a good area. Like advocates who seek to have only corporate practice, advocates who want to join MNCs for a better pay scale and all, they can also think about it.
Like getting it registered means?
You have to take an exam. Primarily, first requirement is that you have to have completed 10 years of experience.
Then that is second, okay. Getting it registered means because
second, you should be a member of an insolvency professional agency.
Okay,
with
sir.
That
okay.
Membership with the agency, you can apply to take up an exam being conducted by IBBI.
Mm-hmm.
On your passing that exam, they have one interview process. And once that interview process is over, they give you a registration certificate certifying that you are a registered insolvency professional.
Okay, sir. Clarified.
Yes.
Thank you very much.
Good day to you, sir. Thank you, Mr. Dinesh Nair. You can unmute yourself. I can go to the next person.
Thank you, sir.
Over to Mr. Shankar Ganesh.
Sir. Hello, sir.
Good,
yeah, sir, I am thankful for a good session, sir. Sir, actually, I have only two doubts, sir. Actually, sir, after becoming a insolvency professional, is there any bar or restriction for continuing his legal practice for an advocate, sir?
Yes, sir. As it is, what the IBBA says is that if you become a registered insolvency professional, there is a bar. But there is not much of clarity because Chartered Account Association has taken up with them. And they are permitted to do certain activities while being an insolvency professional also. So that possibility is there. It is all what the Bar Council has to take up.
It is not a paid profession.
Once you get appointed as an insolvency professional, you get paid for that particular assignment only. So in terms of Bar Council rules, my opinion would be it should not stand in the way. But what the IBBA says is that they want a dedicated professionals. They are looking at an insolvency professional having registered, and with that certificate, you still can't continue as an advocate. You only give your name and take some money. They are not looking at it. They are saying that we need dedicated professionals. So therefore, there are certain stipulations. But for the other professionals, they are given certain exemptions as of now. See, like their chartered accountants, they cannot be a full-time partner in a chartered accountant firm as well as an insolvency professional. But they can do certain certifications. So that is what Bar Council has to take up with IBBA and get it clarified. And then it can go on. For example, being an insolvency professional, an advocate can be permitted to practice before NCLTs. So any matter which he takes up before NCLTs as an advocate can go on. It should not have a conflict or a lack of professionalism in that. This is what is my view. So it has to take shape. As of today, Bar Council, there is no bar. IPBI says that we want a dedicated professional for which they have put in some regulations. Thank so you, suppose sir. Somebody reports after your certification, somebody reports, no, he is a full-time advocate. He is carrying on other things. He is not dedicating his time for the insolvency professional. Then IPBI may take up something for a cancellation of registration. So to avoid that conflict, we have to get into some kind of arrangement with them, get a clarification as to what areas we can go ahead. So this has to take shape.
Thank you, sir. Seniors has to take steps for making it shape.
Yes, sir. We will work towards that.
Thank you, sir. And further, one more doubt, sir. Sorry, sir.
Yes.
Sir, nowadays, the DRDs are not having mechanism to filing this kind of process, sir. When it will come, sir?
No, DRT today is already notified in respect of personal guarantors to corporate debtors. So filing is there. You can file, you can maintain. But only one category. Individuals who are personal guarantor to a company's debt, and there is no proceedings against the company. Because once this was notified sometime last year, November, I did a program for all the DRT staff and presiding officers in South India at the instance of IBBA. So one day we have taken through them completely as to what are all the regulations, what is the forms which they have to use, what is the document they have to look, what is the checklist, everything is done. So today DRTs are bound to accept that. It is notified and they are functioning.
Thank you very much, sir. Thanks for enlightening me, sir. Thank you, sir.
Thank you, Mr. Shankar Ganesh. You can unmute yourself. I'll wish you up to next person. We'll move to Mr. Ayyaswamy Ilangovan.
Yes, sir.
You can sir. Talk to Mr. Ilangovan.
Yes,
sir. Good afternoon, sir. Excellent presentation, sir. Sir, what is the role of an advocate in the entire court, sir? What kind of assistance we can give to debtor or creditor? And what is the grounds we can raise before the NCLT or NCLT? What kind of role we are playing there, sir? Like the presentation of any claim. What will be our role, sir?
Yes, in the entire proceedings before the adjudicating authority, at the first instance, you can be an advocate to any party. So as an advocate, you are entitled to appear before the NCLT, file an application on behalf of the petitioning person, either the creditor or a debtor only, and defend a corporate debtor in cases of applications which they are facing. And in the entire process, there are so many applications which can be filed, so many adjudication process. For example, as I said, preferential transaction, avoidance transaction, fraudulent transaction. See, in a fraudulent transaction application, for an example, I tell you, there is one company which is facing CARP. Now, the RP has come forward with an application naming the ex-directors of the company and a third-party company and its directors, saying that about 6 months back, I find that there is a transfer of about 60 lakhs from this company to that company. There is no corresponding entry as to either purchase or service rendered, nothing. Therefore, I treat it as a fraudulent transaction. This money has to come back. Now, while asking that transaction to be declared as fraudulent and consequential order, he is making the ex-directors, everybody as a party. Now, in this, if he gets an order, there is also a consequence that there can be penal proceedings against the company and individuals because falsification of accounts. So, as an advocate, you have an effective defense mechanism as far as these individuals are concerned. Third parties who are brought in inside. So, all the scope as regarding adjudicating authority and appellate authority, you can represent as an advocate. This is one area. Then, advising the clients. Suppose a person comes to you for initiation of a proceedings, you can advise them. This is the document which you have to look for. This is the application which you have to prepare. And this is the declaration which you have to make. All these advising aspects. Then suppose somebody faces it. Then if it is a financial creditor, as I said, there will not be much of a scope. You have to tell them very clearly. If there is a debt and default, there is not much of a scope. But you can still work out with a creditor for a settlement. You can still work out with a creditor for a resolution. All those things. Suppose if it is an operational creditor who arises a debt based on services rendered or goods supplied. And if there is a bona fide dispute, suppose there is a dispute on the non-delivery of the goods or substandard the quantity or quality of the goods, this you can advise them. You have to get the required documents. And these are all the areas which we have a huge scope as an advocates to do. Other than insolvency professional, you can even become an insolvency professional and work on those things.
Thank you, sir.
Thank you, sir.
You can unmute yourself. I'll move to... Miss V. Rajeshwari. Miss Rajeshwari?
Yes, sir. Actually, I have a doubt. Yeah. Sir, I just wanted to ask.
Yes.
Before the last person, one person was asking about the competency to practice after taking up this IP profession.
Yes.
RP profession.
Yes.
There, under the code of conduct,
yes.
There is regulation 23, which says, it's amended one as on 23rd July 2019. An insolvency professional must not engage in any employment when he holds a valid authorization for assignment or when he is undertaking an assignment. Does it in profession also that the insolvency professional should not practice the profession like that?
That is what I said. It doesn't mean the profession. Right? Profession is not an engagement for profit or anything. Profession stands on a different standing. Now, conflict of this provision with Bar Council, there is nothing. As it is Bar Council enrollment which is there, you cannot be subjected to any kind of proceedings for suspension of your enrollment. But conflict of this provision when it goes before IBBA by way of a complaint or somebody, what is the parameters is today a question. Whether the IBBA is going to accept that carrying on your profession as an advocate is not in conflict of this particular regulation or not is not yet tested. That is what I said. But chartered accountants got a clarification on that issue. But as of our advocates, we don't have. Suppose if you, as an advocate, continue to be a partner in a firm, there may be a conflict. Then you are not dedicating yourself fully to this profession. So this is an area which has to be worked out by getting clarification from IBBA, then streamlining the entire activity.
That will be applicable
one
to all.
One view is that there cannot be anything which can stop an advocate from practicing his profession.
So far not tested. No, so far not.
Yes.
There is no clarity.
Yes.
Okay, sir. Thank you.
Thank you very much.
Thank you, Ms. Rajeshwari. You can unmute yourself. I'll go to next person. Mr. CSK Satish, advocate. Mr. Satish.
Good afternoon, sir.
Good afternoon, sir.
Yeah, you can talk to him.
Sir, in this court,
yes,
against the order of the adjudicating authority, that is NCLT,
yes,
a statutory appeal is permitted to NCLT under 61.
Yes.
And to a statutory appeal under 62 to the Honorable Supreme Court.
Yes.
Now, see, what is the scope and the possibility of a litigant, may it be a creditor or a debtor, to invoke Article 226 for our Honorable High Court? Because normally we see in DRT matters, the statute provides appeal to DRAT.
Yes.
However, in some cases, we approach the Honorable High Court under 226.
Yes.
And deserving cases, Honorable High Court intervenes, and the other cases, it relegates to a regular court of appeal.
Yes.
Now, as far as IBC, since it's been a different legislation, sir, what is the scope, sir, under 226? Is it still possible for us to invoke?
See, as of now, in terms of the provisions of the code, NCLT and from NCLT, an appeal remedy to the NCLAT. And that appeal remedy is against any order by any person. Then a further appeal to Supreme Court on a limited question of, only on the question of law. This is the scheme of the code. And in few judgments, Supreme Court, while interpreting the earlier economic legislations like DRT and SERFACE, had laid down the law in very, very clear terms saying that when there is an appeal remedy, High Court is not supposed to interfere in 226 or 227. So that has been the law as it is prevailing. Now, interestingly, even under IBC, there have been one or two cases which landed before Supreme Court, and Supreme Court said that High Court is not expected to interfere in this matter. More particularly, if you read that Swiss judgment, Supreme Court treats this as an economic legislation in a specified area. Therefore, judicial review powers itself is very much limited. Even NCLT, NCLAT power is tested in that SR Steel's case also, latest judgment, on a specific heading by the Supreme Court as to what is the scope of your judicial review. If that is the situation, the interference by High Court is very, very, very minimal. But it doesn't mean that High Court cannot exercise a power under 226 and 227. More particularly in 227, it has a supervisory jurisdiction over all subordinate tribunals. In 226, when a case is really put forth, which requires an interference, it will refer. But in normal terms, if there is an appeal remedy as against grievance of an order, you cannot come to High Court. it may be on an extraordinary situation as to gross illegality. Now, one light at the end of the tunnel is that one decision of the Honorable Supreme Court in the case of Embassy Properties Limited, where Supreme Court said, in cases of conflict as between the provisions of IBC with that of public law remedies, Supreme Court said, NCLT has no jurisdiction, therefore High Court will exercise. That was a case where a cancellation of a mining lease was the issue. NCLT said that during moratorium, you could not have cancelled the mining lease. But Supreme Court said, it is a public law issue and it can only go before the High Court. NCLT has no jurisdiction. So with that judgment, some scope is opened up as far as 227 and 228, 226 is concerned. But interestingly, post that embassy judgment, government came with again amendment. And in that amendment, government said, all these government contracts cannot also be cancelled during the moratorium period. So that is how the law has been proceeding with this fourth and that fourth, with the courts at one stage and the government at one stage and the provisions of law.
Thank you, sir. Thank you.
Yes, thank you.
Mr. Satish, you can unmute yourself. I'll go to the next person. Mr. Yesil Sudarshanam. Mr. Sudarshanam.
Yeah.
So, good afternoon.
How about you, sir? Fine. Thank you for the good section, sir. Sir, I have a query on this particular aspect. After the IRP is appointed, there's a time frame calling upon claims and he makes a publication and so on. He follows the procedure to call for the claims in order to finish within the time span.
Yes, yes.
Sir, now 180 days, then you have another up to another 30 days. It goes on like that, sir.
Yes.
Do you feel what happens? I would like to have two limbs on this question. If I miss my claim within the time span, and do you feel this calling for claims, the mechanism followed by IRP, is it sufficient? Or do you recommend any other procedure because it should reach widely? And if I miss the bus within the time frame, I lose my claim. So what is your opinion? What is your view on this, sir?
See, as it is in the present scenario, the submission of claims at the first instance is within 30 days from the publication, which is actually submission is within 7 days. And collating of the claims happens by the RP within 23 days and first meeting of COC within 30 days. But still the provision rules and regulations says that till 120 days you can submit and the RP can collate and he can add on to that. So whatever COC constituted will not become defective. Whatever decisions taken will not be defective. That is clearly provided in the provisions. So any claims which come later also can be added on. This is one thing. And secondly, if it goes for liquidation again at that stage, there is a provision which calls for claims. So this is what is available. So in spite of which somebody misses it, the Supreme Court judgment in one of the paragraphs, in fact, clearly says that if you have missed, you have missed. It is binding on you. So it is a bit of stringent provision. So if you are in a process of, carrying on a business with somebody, you are bound to know what the business concern is doing. See, once the court comes with a time-driven project, it also looks at that you cannot leave a debt unclaimed or not looking at what happens to the company for 3 months, 6 months, and then suddenly waking up. So that is being driven. Now, as regarding your query, is there requirement of any other procedure? One is publications which are happening. If any other procedure is stipulated, that is going to create a cause. So therefore, what is happening today is that other than publication, many of the RPs, once they take up the books of account, and if they find that there are some other creditors and they have not made the claim, they are also intimating them. Now, going further, IBBA is looking at that all these things should be brought in a transparent manner, put up in the website of the company or website of IBBA. Today, one of the best websites which I have seen is IBBA website. Each one of you can just enter once that IBBA website. It gives a complete list of what are all the companies which are going on CIRP process, what are the companies where resolution plans have been implemented. It gives even the value of companies as disclosed by the RP. So much of transparency is there. And you can find out if there is any proceedings against companies. So maybe down the line, this transparency should be further developed in terms of information utilities being reporting all these things. So a system should devolve where like your auditors or somebody who is monitoring and who is helping out, they should be able to tell you monthly once or something that these are all the issues which are there, these companies facing, so why you can't you make a claim. So that can be the system. I don't foresee any amendment to the provision to expand that scope of calling for claims. And that will again give room for so many people saying that in most of the cases, our litigations are getting stuck in only in this. If there is a provision for sending notice, then again, notice is sent. I have not received. It has not been properly served. These issues will crop up. As of now, the code is serving its purpose as far as these claims are concerned.
Thank you so much, sir.
Thank you. Thank you, sir.
Thank you, Ms. Swan. I can unmute yourself. Let me just move to Ms. Hemalata Suresh. Hemalata Suresh, ma'am. Hello. You can talk to Mr. Alan. Yeah.
Good afternoon.
Thank you, sir. Good afternoon, sir.
Yes.
Sir, once a claim petition is submitted before the IRP and after the COD is conducted, the IRP found that there was no asset available or the company is not, the directors of the company is not traceable. Whether that claim petition can be withdrawn?
The application filed before the NCLT for initiation of CIRP, you are meaning that?
Yes, yes.
It is not a question of withdrawing. Under section 12A, it says during the process of CIRP, if there is a resolution by the financial creditors on a settlement, it can be withdrawn. It is not a simple step withdrawn. Once it is admitted, process starts. There is no stopping of it. Only by way of a resolution it can, or you can record a settlement, or you can ask the financial creditor to pass a resolution to say that it is, let it be withdrawn, we will work out other means. So that can be done. 12A provides
the debtors is not traceable.
The person who has initiated cannot withdraw unless there is a resolution under 12A.
Then the operation with the debtor can withdraw.
Yes, unless the financial creditors pass a resolution, it cannot be. The committee of creditors have to make a decision. Thank you very much. Thank you all.
I should thank you for the excellent lecture. And it was very erudite and as well as simple and lucid. I think as NAVJ has suggested, once the individual insolvency is notified, I think there will be a bloom in the, what is called, number of practitioners following IBC code. Let us wait for that to happen, sir. And thanks a lot for your
Thank you. Thank you, Srinivas Raghavan. Thank you, Hemalata. Thank you very much.
Thanks a lot, sir. Thank you.